Rick, thanks very much. Happening now, the President of the United States, he's taking the world stage right here in New York City. He's pushing critical U.S. objectives across the Middle East, hailing the international mission in Libya as a model for the 21st century. Plus, my special interview with the former President of the United States, Bill Clinton. He's now on a global push of his own. His fears for the country's economic recovery, what he says is sad about Washington right now, and a sobering message for voters, all that's coming up. And did top female staffers in the Obama White House suffer a hostile working environment? The mounting fallout from an explosive new book. I'm Wolf Blitzer at the Clinton Global Initiative in New York. You're in the Situation Room. All right, we're reporting today from the annual meeting in the Clinton Global Initiative here in New York City, covering this major forum for international leaders all week. And I had a chance to sit down earlier in the day with the former President Bill Clinton for an extensive, far-reaching interview. You're going to go see that. You're going to see that interview. Part of it will air this hour, part in the next hour. I want you to stand by. Meanwhile, only a few blocks away here in Manhattan at the United Nations, President Obama is on a major diplomatic mission of his own, and a number of critical issues are on the table. Let's bring in our chief White House correspondent, Jessica Yellen. She's with me here at the Clinton Global Initiative, watching all of this unfold. A huge day today. Maybe even a more important day for the president tomorrow.
That's right, Wolf. But first, today it was a major day of diplomacy for the president. Today, he met with the new leaders of a post-Gaddafi Libya, a moment of triumph for this administration. And the president's aides emphasized that the U.S. will be reopening its embassy in Libya later this week. And tomorrow, the president will have to do a delicate dance when he addresses the U.N. Last year, when he appeared before the U.N., the president said at this time he would hope to be able to announce a Palestinian state. But since that time, peace talks with Israel have stalled. There have been no major advancements. And now the Palestinians have made clear that they will come to the U.N. and in one way or another make a play for a vote for statehood here at the United Nations. And the president, in his speech, will have to explain why the U.S. will block such a move. Now, that for the U.S. is a potentially awkward explanation, given that the president has stood for freedom and statehood in other Arab nations during the Arab Spring. The Palestinians are expected to make that play for statehood, Wolf, sometime after the president leaves New York.
Because that speech that Mahmoud Abbas, the Palestinian Authority president, I think is scheduled for Friday.
Correct.
Right now. All right, thanks very much. Jessica is going to be staying with us today, tomorrow, throughout the week. Appreciate it. We're going to get to my in-depth interview with former President Bill Clinton in just a few minutes. We're going to find out what he thinks about the anti-Washington movement in politics. Stand by for that. But let's check in with Jack Cafferty right now. He's in New York with the Cafferty File. Jack.
And you're in New York with me. You're just across on the east side. Thanks, Wolf. There are a lot of unhappy Democrats these days, and some of them are setting their sights directly on President Obama. A group of liberal leaders says they want to field a slate of candidates against the president in the primaries. Just what the president wants to hear. Ralph Nader tells the Washington Times that without an intra-party challenge, the liberal agenda will be ignored. He says Obama running unopposed will kill voter enthusiasm and that voters won't get to see the real differences between Democrats and Republicans. More than 45 liberal leaders support this idea. They point to President Obama's handling of the Wall Street bailouts, the wars, Libya, the extension of the Bush tax cuts, and the debt ceiling deal. Just a short list of their grievances. Meanwhile, the head of the Congressional Black Caucus says that unhappy members of his group would probably be marching on the White House if Mr. Obama weren't president. Black leaders have been begging the president to address unemployment among African Americans, which stands at close to 17%, almost double the national average. And finally, one of Mr. Obama's hometown newspapers, the Chicago Tribune, is running a column called Why Obama Should Withdraw. Columnist Steve Chapman suggests not running for re-election might be sensible for Mr. Obama to do. He says the president might do the party a favor by stepping aside, taking the blame, and letting someone else replace him at the top of the ticket. Someone like, say, Hillary Clinton. Here's the question. How much of a problem does President Obama have with his own party? Go to CNN.com/Cafferty File, post a comment on my blog, or go to our post on the Situation Room's Facebook page. I suppose at the end of the day, if you don't want to vote for a Republican, you're going to vote for the president for a second term. But at the moment, he's got some problems.
He certainly does. President Obama on the offensive with growing economic fears across the country and fierce backlash coming in from Republican leaders on Capitol Hill. All of it a source of serious concern for the former president of the United States, Bill Clinton.
Mr. President, good to see you at the Clinton Global Initiative. Another year, it's really moving very quickly, and it's jobs, jobs, jobs right now. This is an enormous crisis, and potentially it could get a whole lot worse.
It could, and it could get better. And, you know, what we're trying to do here is to just come up with concrete things that can be done, not just in the United States, but elsewhere, to put Americans back to work. And when we met in Chicago in June or July, we talked about how to put America back to work. And today we had a good manifestation of that with the announcement by the AFL-CIO and the American Federation of Teachers that they were releasing a lot more money to try to put their members and other people, construction workers, back to work retrofitting buildings. And they're going to create an enormous number of jobs doing this.
But you know there's political gridlock in Washington. The president comes up with these initiatives, these plans, as he's done this week, but you know it's not going to go anywhere as far as the Republican majority in the House of Representatives is concerned.
Well, I think it's sad, but the people, they were elected by the American people essentially on the promise of doing nothing except to try to, you know, give us a lot less government. And then in the Senate, I think they'll block anything because they're afraid it will work.
Senator you need 60 votes in the Senate.
Yeah, Senator McConnell says his main goal in life is to defeat the president for re-election. So that's what it is. But I still think the president had to propose these things. And ultimately, the American people are just going to have to decide what kind of country they want and vote for it. They voted now for, in 2006 and 2008, they voted for one kind of country to take a move away from the policies of the previous several years. Then in 2010, they voted to take a U-turn. And I don't think they really think like that. I think they think, well, we need a little more of this, a little less of that. But they voted for quite a radical departure. And so, you know, it's interesting to me to see the voters sit around and condemn the politicians that they elected who are doing what they promised to do during the election.
My sense is, and you and I, we had different jobs, but 95, 96, when the government was shut down, as you remember, just before you were reelected, as bitter as the acrimony was in Washington then, and I covered it. I was the White House correspondent covering your administration. I think it's worse now, but you tell me what you think.
It could be. I don't know. You would know better than me because I'm not there all the time. I think basically, but the American people, all I'm saying is they keep giving Congress low ratings and the White House low ratings. They need to take a little ownership here. Every one of these people got in power because they were voted for.
They were democratically elected.
Yes, and none of them, there's now a determined effort to restrict the franchise and kind of thwart the meaning of democratic elections, but all these people were. And, you know, you should pay attention to what people say. When they run for office, they pretty much try to do what they said they're going to do. And I will give it to the Tea Party Republicans. They, if you paid attention, they're doing what they said they were going to do. And the voters now seem to be upset by it.
Did you see that debate that I moderated in Tampa?
I saw some of it, yeah.
What did you think of those guys up there on the stage?
Well, you know, there's a range of what I think. I the more moderate ones, as you might imagine, are the ones that I think would be better presidents. I was, like a lot of people, quite disturbed that there were those who were cheering when you ask if a man who needed life-saving care but didn't have health insurance should be allowed to die, and there seemed to be cheering. But, you know, it's all political theater now. That is, look at the difference in what we're doing here and what happens in the campaign. And I sympathize with you because you got to run all these news programs. Now, it looks to me like what's good politics in the modern world, at least when times are tough, is conflict. And it also makes for edgier news coverage. And yet in the real world where jobs are created, what works is cooperation. So it's not the government versus the private sector. It's what they can do together to create prosperity. And if you look at, let's take San Diego, center of biotechnology in America, more Nobel Prize winning scientists than any other American city. No longer primarily a Navy city, it's a biotech city. The Silicon Valley is back. Orlando has 100 computer simulation companies. Pittsburgh is trying to go from being the city of steel to the city of nanotechnology. Cleveland is using a Cleveland Clinic to try to retrofit, if you will, not buildings, the workforce. So there are these centers of prosperity in America. Every one of them works because people cooperate, not because there's conflict. But conflict is good politics. That's how you get elected.
You said some of the Republican candidates are more moderate than the others. Let's talk about that for a second. Who do you like and who are you concerned about? Not from the political standpoint, but from the standpoint of America's future.
Well, it appears that that Governor Huntsman and Governor Romney, at least, have not come out in just flat-out denial of climate change. It appears that Governor Huntsman said he supported the compromise to raise the debt ceiling because America couldn't afford the economic consequences of debt default. That used to be the position of every responsible American. That now passes for a moderate to liberal position in the Republican Party. He was the only candidate for president who supported, you know, not defaulting on our debt. So, you know, I don't have anything against the others. I admire a lot of things about the other candidates, but I think that there is no evidence anywhere in the world of a successful country that has such a bitter anti-government philosophy.
Like Rick Perry has?
Yeah, he said, you know, get America, get Washington as far away as possible. Of course, it's interesting because an enormous percentage of the jobs created in Texas since the financial meltdown, not before, before they really were doing great. But he's done pretty well with government funding, closing his budget gaps, creating public jobs. But nonetheless, he's, you know, anti-government, this whole anti-government thing. And it sounds so good, but there's not an example of a successful country. You work around the world, the countries that are growing faster than we are have lower unemployment rates than we do, have, you know, less income inequality than we do. Without exception, they have a good government and a good economy. They don't run against the government. They use the government and the economy work together. And so what's good politics for them is there's just not any example in the world of the country working better, doing what they advocate. Not a single one.
So what I hear you saying is you'd be happier if Romney or Huntsman got the nomination than Rick Perry.
Well, it's not up to me to pick. They'll both lose if anybody thinks I've endorsed them. I'm just saying that I appreciate the fact that they're trying to navigate a landscape that bears almost no relationship to what's produced successful economies in the world. And there are lots of countries that are now doing better than we are in some areas because of the very ideas that apparently you have to support to get the nomination. And it bothers me because I think we need a Republican-Democratic debate and discussion about how best to change the way we produce and consume energy and how best to revive the economy and how best to incorporate the need for cultural norms like the value of work and family as well as government programs to help get through this tough time. And we can't get it because you're either for or against the government. And if you're an anti-government guy, you got to be, say, every tax is bad, every regulation is bad, every program is bad. First, it's factually not true, and secondly, it's really distorting our politics.
We're going to have much more of my interview with the former President Bill Clinton, including serious concerns looming over the Middle East right now over a showdown underway at the United Nations. More of the interview coming up. Should the U.S., for example, be worried about any retaliatory violence against U.S. interests overseas, depending on what happens in New York this week? Also, hot water for the White House over that solar energy company that went bankrupt after receiving millions of dollars in taxpayer money.
To Hillary Clinton, keep fighting for us.
TeamHillaryClinton.com.